do you have to normally have a larger pot size with these amendments that have lower NPK for your grow?
Whether it be a medicinal plant or tomatoes or whatever you're harvesting. When we take that biomass from that single plant, we're literally taking like 1,800, 1,200 milligrams of elements from the ground. In nature, nature's not throwing a bunch of amendments on the ground. It's throwing what it created
right
above itself on the ground.
How much amendments do you add to your soil initially? And then how much do you re-amend your soil in between each grow?
Personally, I like alfalfa meal, kelp meals, a lot of the different plant meals. They may not have high NPK ratios, but they have a little bit of everything.
Have you ever wondered how much mass your plants are actually using when they're growing? Well, in this video, we're going to get into it. You're here with Green Goblin 510, Mark Bowell, and the rest of the team here on Perfect Gardens TV. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. And if you haven't heard about a $2.99 membership, make sure to check out the link down below. If you think you need a little more one-on-one, I always have my VIP down below in the description as well.
Make sure to hit the join button on the bottom of every video. This is what leads to our next question is for using dry amendments, using like, again, I'm going to throw in the bat guano, the seabird guano, the bone meal, throwing in all those amendments. What I found that really that sweet range of veg, no more than 4 weeks, 5 weeks max, between a 7 and 10 gallon is the bare minimum size. If you're using these other dry amendments, like, again, I don't want to say plant-based, but what you're saying, like these other, like kelp, but, and I find them to be probably, I mean, tell me if I'm wrong, but the plant-based ones seem to normally be less in NPK ratios too.
Correct.
So what I'm asking is, do you have to normally have a larger pot size with these amendments that have lower NPK for your grow? And do you normally go for a longer veg time for that reason?
I operate in anywhere from 10 to 15 gallons in flower, and that seems to do really well for me. A lot of my big NPK comes from good compost. If you have a good selection or a good source of really good compost, a good portions of your NPKs are going to come from that, because it's a big breakdown of several hundred plants, wood, all different kinds of carbon and nitrogen sources, basically.
Many different states too, what they're in, you know, from the fresh on the top of the forest floor, as you dig deeper, you know, it's like, I reuse my soil. It's like, there's chunks of biochar that are getting smaller and smaller. Mm-hmm. And the last, I just re-amended my soil. I broke open a piece of biochar, man. There was like little roots, and it was like a whole nother world in there. I was just like, man, like, how cool is this? Like, I get excited over that type of stuff. Like, it intrigues me to keep engaging my kids and like break out the microscope, check this out. Like, look at the, even if they don't really care, it just mm-hmm. keeps my mindset and my connection with earth and my plants true, you know, and it's hard to do.
Oh, absolutely.
You know,
another interesting thing is like, we put all these amendments in our soil and we see this plant grow and create a whole bunch of biomass, and we're harvesting this biomass. We even put it on a scale to see how much biomass we got. And we're like, that's a decent amount. It actually doesn't take a lot out of the soil to create that amount of biomass. It takes milligrams of said element to create that biomass. And we're adding grams, sometimes pounds, of these amendments to our soil. It's there. The nutrients are there. What we're pulling out of the soil isn't as much as what a lot of people think when we harvest a crop, whether it be a medicinal plant or tomatoes or whatever you're harvesting. When we take that biomass from that single plant, we're literally taking like 1,800, 1,200 milligrams of elements from the ground.
Yeah. And I'm asking you this question because that's a very fascinating thought process I've never really thought about. And I'm asking you this question more just so I can study up more on this. Where did this thought process come from? Because that is very interesting. It's like you're saying, if you have a pound of material biomass, I mean, when you say 1200, or let's say 1200 or 1800, are you talking about just the biomass, or are you talking about with the stem and all that other stuff? What, like
everything.
Everything.
So the entire plant. Yep.
So that's really interesting. Where did you hear that from, if you don't mind me asking? Like, or did you, was that original thought? Where did that come from? I'd love to dive in deeper on that.
I'll have to find it. There's been a couple of studies that come out recently on this, with the help of Dr. Lane Ingram and a few other people, they've been quite literally measuring how much plants take out of the soil.
That's by fascinating. Wow.
Like, because they have the funding to do so now, they can do 500,000 tests and get the granular data that they need. And we're starting to figure out, and it kind of makes a lot of sense, because in nature, nature's not throwing a bunch of amendments on the ground. It's throwing what it created
right
above itself on the ground. And an animal might come along and die right there as well. Or, you know, wind might blow in some things. But in nature, they're not throwing pounds of a particular amendment on a certain area. It's just using the dead grass that fell over there, the dead weeds that fell over there, tree leaves, anything else. And that's all composting on that top layer and adding all the NPK, micronutrients, macronutrients, all right back to the soil right there. And, you know, trees and forests live on forever and ever.
You know, if anyone's ever walked on a uncut forest, every foot, I mean, a real uncut forest, somewhere places where people haven't walked in 50 years, every foot you take, your foot is going down 3 feet, 4 feet. You know what I mean?
You sink into it.
It is. And that really is interesting about what you said. It's like, I mean, how many animals are going to die, right? It's like, they're not, I mean, lay down. It's like one piece of carcass. And I've said this in my nitrogen video, actually, too, a long ass time ago. It's like, it's not like a whole bunch of animals die right there on the waterfront. It creates nitrogen toxicity, you know, but I never really connected what you just said. Again, it's like, you're absolutely right. And
adding to that too, is nature also, we can't forget, nature has the ability to govern itself. So, oh, we have good sun, lots of water this year. I'm going to grow a lot this year. You know, look at a tree, the growth of the rings. So kind of matching that within your system, whether you're in a 2x2 tent, a 4x4 tent, and how much you're pushing, because it might use less, but if the demand above the sun and everything you're trying to do it, then you might need more. And forests are such good regulators of that. And they can communicate that to their saplings and stuff like, hey, we're not going to grow too much this year. We're going to preserve that. Or even certain pines that hold on to their seeds for, you know, hundreds of years. Yeah. Up to hundreds of years. To have a forest fire to finally release them down into the forest floor. So, you know, understanding that our plants, you know, they want to regulate, they want to communicate with their soil, the roots and the microbes, and let them be, let them figure it out and try to match that with your environment, you know, and that's, it's not an easy thing to do. I'm in Northern Illinois. Summers are extremely humid. Now it's winter. I can barely keep up with the humidity, 2 gallons a day, just going in the air, just trying to, you know,
I'm in Michigan. So yeah, I feel it.
Yeah. I mean, so, you know, sometimes this, not even focusing so much on the food, but the environment and matching it to what the plants, you know, genetically capable of doing, you know.
It leads right into that next question is, how do you recycle your soil? With this level of awareness of how much milligrams the plant actually needs, if you had 100% of bioavailability in your soil and everything was connected, how much amendments do you add into your soil and how much do you re-amend that same soil? And I'm not trying to add a question on to a question on a question, but I think it's all kind of
it
like
leads one, on, yeah.
It's one question really is, how much amendments do you add to your soil initially? And then how much do you re-amend your soil in between each grow? And if you don't re-amend it in between each grow, how often do you actually re-amend?
I start off with very baseline soil, basically. So it's not supercharged. I'm not throwing a bunch of amendments at it. I start off like that on purpose. And then usually 30 days in, I'm going to do a top dress of around 1 cup of all the different amendments that I have, whether that be like a build a soil craft blend amendment blend, or if I made my own blend up because I couldn't get build a soil craft blend quickly enough or whatever. Because like I said, I'll use whatever I can get my hands on. So usually it's just a literal 1 cup, 30 days after veg, like right before you're transitioning into flowering. And then 2 weeks into flower, I'll do another top dress, and the rest of the time I'm using a tea. Maybe right as I do that top dress in the flower, I'll use a tea to help get everything going still and make sure everything's going well to break down all those amendments. But other than that, I don't re-amend a lot. Like I have 4 30-gallon trash cans in which I always have on hand that have soil in it, and I use maybe 50 or 60 pounds of amendments per year.
Not to throw you on the spot, could you share your screen? Could you show us the live cam or no?
What are those amendments that you purchase specifically, if you don't mind me asking?
Personally, I like alfalfa meal, kelp meals, a lot of the different plant meals. They may not have high NPK ratios, but they have a little bit of everything. And that's what I'm going for. That's what the microbes like, and that's what the plant like. Just like when you're feeding with synthetics, the goal is to not feed them too much and have them always wanting for more so they keep uptaking it. The same goal is kind of there for the microbes. If you give them way too much sugars and foods and this, that, the other thing, they're just going to be like, cool, I'm going to chill here. I got everything. Right.
They're propagating. They're just doing their own thing. They're segregating in different root zones. They're not in sync. I like that.
You're bringing the hot pockets to them. Right.
So the Excel spreadsheet we're going to be going over actually has close to 10,000 separate data points, as you can see right here, going worldwide of anything and everything you can run into, from cities and states, everything across the board.